they would first see would be this sign here, unwise might pray, which would mean work will set you free. It was a cruel taunt, but it was the only hope they had, the idea that if you worked hard enough, that was how you would achieve your freedom. But what that meant or when that would be were simply not known, and people worked, and they worked to the point of death. But that was the beginning of Auschwitz, the one of the largest concentration camps, and here in Dachau, the first concentration camp. So the way you're entering now is the way that the prisoners would have entered, being told that they were going to be put into protective custody, which is always an interesting phrase, protective custody. Sounds like they're doing you a favor, doesn't it? It's photos of this historic place. Actually, not so historic. It was stolen a couple of Novembers ago. But it looks the same. So get a photo of it. Basically, this wall was erected, and everything around here is here for a memorial site. If it hadn't been for Dachau, then Auschwitz would never have existed, because there always has to be a beginning. There always has to be some start to everything. 32,000 people that were crammed in here. It was not made for more than 5,000 people, but 32,000 there would be crammed in, and the living conditions were just horrible. I'll point out a few things as we walk over here. Would be where the prisoners would stand for roll call. Is anybody feeling chilly, a little cold right now, Floridians? Imagine if you had no hat and scarf or coat and you were wearing thin striped pajamas, and that would be it, and you had to stand for hours. I think the complaining would begin early. Except you would not be permitted to complain or to break ranks. But that sculpture up there that looks so horrible, that tangled mass of humanity, that was not here then. That was made by an artist to commemorate all of this up here, which was illustrated by the people in that later, which you can see 1933 to 1945. This wasn't turned into a memorial site until the early 1960s. And every German student is required to visit one concentration camp during their school years. So these would have been the barracks where they would have stayed. Now, don't think that it would have been one or, you know, one person to a monk. You might have had as many as four soldiers, but they would have been crammed in here. That's why it was so easy for a disease to spread. These that you're in now are rebuilt. Everything had to be burned down because of the amount of disease that had taken over. Somebody here living in unsanitary conditions, but I can show you with that window all of the foundations where all the other buildings would have been.
All of those rectangular stone areas would have been other buildings.
The entire site of Dachau was chosen because it was a former munition site. They wanted the war machine to go on. They needed people to make uniforms, to make roads, to make munitions. All of those things needed to be done if they were going to have a war effort. So slave labor was very, very important in the area. One of the questions that people ask are, was anybody else aware? Were the people in the towns area aware? How could they let this happen? Well, the people in Dachau, in the area of Dachau, didn't know. Some of them felt sorry for those that were prisoners. Some ignored it. Some would give them a piece of bread. But it wasn't something that was completely unknown. The extent to which the horrors occurred may have been not known to the average person, but surely they were aware that there were prison camps there, but they were probably thinking that these were people that deserved to be in these prisons, and so there's little that we can do about that when it happens. In 1945, when they were liberated, there were some prisoners that stayed longer here after they were liberated than before they were liberated. So where were they? It was a huge logistical mess. And they wanted to find out, at that time, many of the Jewish people in all these concentration camps, if they had survived. And they wanted to know, where do you want to go? Where can we take you? All their property and all of their belongings had been confiscated by the Germans, or had been burned, or had been destroyed. So where do you want to go? Where do you have family? And so they would turn in these cards, and they would say, we want to go home. We want to go to Palestine. Now, at the time, after World War I, Palestine had been part of the Ottoman Empire. When World War I was lost, those parts of the world were divided up between the winning powers, France and England and the U.S., and England had control over what is today Israel, before it became the state of Israel. And there were Jews that had always lived there, and they were saying, it's time for us to go back, time for us to go back to our historic homeland. And they were saying, no, we've got quotas, we can't send you all back. There's a lot of Arabs that live there now, there are our Jews that make trouble, so we can't just send you all back, so give us a second choice. And so they wrote back on their second choice, we'd like to go to Palestine. And they said, okay, you don't understand, we can't send you all back there, pick another place. And the third time the cards came in, and this time the card says, we want to go to the crematorium. We want to be burned. We would rather die than continue living like this. It is time, they said, it is time that we as Jewish people had a place that is our home, that we can protect, that we can call our own, that we can live as Jews among Jews, because here we cannot. Because the life of a Jew was worth nothing, and the life of these prisoners was worth nothing.